Sepsis in pregnancy. Sepsis is actually our enemy because we need to protect pregnant women and postpartum women from sepsis because it has a very high morbidity and mortality if it happens. Sepsis in pregnancy remains an important cause of maternal death. It was identified in confidential inquiry in maternal and child death that substandard care was identified in many of the cases. In particular, lack of recognition of signs of sepsis and lack of guidelines on the investigation and management of genital tract sepsis. That's why all healthcare professionals should be alert about the risk factor for sepsis, early warning signs and symptoms of sepsis, and the proper management of sepsis. So what is sepsis? Sepsis may be defined as infection plus systemic manifestation of infection. Severe sepsis may be defined as sepsis plus sepsis-induced organ dysfunction or tissue hyperperfusion. Septic shock is defined as the persistence of hypoperfusion despite adequate fluid replacement. So what are the risk factors for sepsis? Risk factors for sepsis include obesity, diabetes, impaired immunity or immunosuppression, anemia, black ethnic minority, amniocentesis or other invasive procedures, cervical cerclage, prolonged spontaneous rupture of membranes, prolonged labor, unsafe termination of pregnancy, vaginal discharge or history of pelvic infection, history of group B streptococcal infection, group A streptococcal infection in close contact or family member. These are all risk factors which can lead to sepsis. Causative organisms for sepsis, the major pathogen causing sepsis, group A streptococcus, also known as Streptococcus biogene, Escherichia coli, Staph aureus, Strep pneumonia, MRSA, Clostridium septicum, and Morganella morgani. These are the organisms which can cause sepsis in pregnancy and postpartum. Progression of sepsis. Sepsis starts as an infection, then it progresses to bacteremia, then systemic inflammatory response, then sepsis, then septic shock. Clinical features suggestive of sepsis, fever or rigor, diarrhea or vomiting, may indicate toxin production, early toxic shock, rash, generalized streptococcal macrolide rash or purpura fulminans, abdominal pelvic pain and tenderness, offensive vaginal discharge, smelly, suggest anaerobe, serotanginous, suggest streptococcal infection, productive cough, urinary symptoms. Clinical signs suggestive of sepsis include one or more of the following: pyrexia, hypothermia, tachycardia, tachypnea, hypoxia, hypotension, oliguria, impaired consciousness, failure to respond to treatment. These signs, including pyrexia, may not always be present and are not necessarily relating to the severity of sepsis. That's why regular observation of all vital signs, including temperature, pulse, blood pressure, and respiratory rate, should be recorded on MUSE chart. Genital tract sepsis may present with constant severe pain and tenderness unrelieved by usual analgesia. This should prompt urgent review. This is very important in patients who have cesarean section. Usually they will complain of pain around side of scar, which is explained, but this pain should be manageable by analgesics. But if the pain starts to be severe and not manageable by analgesics, you have to be cautious and alerted about a collection inside causing sepsis. Same thing with pain at the episiotomy site. If this pain starts to be not manageable by analgesics, this should alert the possibility of sepsis. Severe infection may be associated with preterm labor. Toxic shock syndrome, usually caused by staph or strep toxin, can produce confusing symptoms including nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, severe pain out of proportion to clinical signs due to necrotizing fasciitis, watery vaginal discharge, generalized rash, and conjunctival insufficient. Here I would like to highlight the importance of toxic shock syndrome and the importance of necrotizing fasciitis because they are rare but serious, life-threatening, and should require prompt evaluation, prompt recognition, and prompt management. In sepsis, time is essence. Tic-tac. Remember that you have 1 hour to do the necessary basic investigation and treatment for sepsis. This is what we call the golden hour. This hour is essential to protect the patient. Tasks to be performed within the first 6 hours of identification of severe sepsis. This modified from surviving sepsis campaign registration bundle. Obtain blood culture prior to antibiotic administration. Administer broad-spectrum antibiotics within 1 hour of recognition of severe sepsis. Measure serum lactate. In the event of hypotension and or serum lactate less than 4 mmol per liter, deliver an initial minimum of 20 mL per kg crystalloid or equivalent. Apply vasopressors for hypotension that not responding to initial flow resuscitation to maintain mean arterial pressure of 65 mmHg. In the event of persistent hypotension despite flow resuscitation, which we call it septic shock, and or lactate more than 4 mmol, you need to achieve central venous pressure of more than 8 mmHg, achieve central venous oxygen saturation of more than 70%, or maxed venous oxygen saturation of more than 65%. So why I said at the start, sepsis is our enemy? What's the challenges? Why sepsis can be easily misdiagnosed in pregnancy? Because usually there are signs in pregnancy which is similar to sepsis. We are very comfortable with high heart rate and low blood pressure. We attribute that to the normal physiology of pregnancy. We fail to count the pulse and especially respiratory rate. We tend to identify and treat late due to decreased vigilance, since sepsis is now relatively rare, failure to order appropriate labs including lactate, reluctant to treat infection until source identified. Young healthy patients can log very well until they are almost dead. Non-specific nature of its presentation in this population. So it's very important to tackle sepsis in a timely fashion. It was found that in UK confidential inquiry of maternal and child health in cases of sepsis that care often less than optimal. There were some cases where doctors said they were already so busy dealing with other urgent problems that they were unable to see women for some time after admission. It was also clear that many doctors, midwives, and community midwives were unfamiliar with the signs and symptoms of sepsis, didn't realize when a woman was deteriorating or critically ill, and failed to appreciate how quickly the clinical condition of a septic woman can deteriorate. Red flag symptoms and signs in sepsis is pyrexia more than 38, sustained tachycardia more than 90 beats per minute, breathlessness, respiratory rate more than 20 breaths per minute, abdominal or chest pain, diarrhea or vomiting, uterine or renal angle pain and tenderness, woman generally unwell and seems anxious and distressed. Early presentation of sepsis less than 12 hours post-birth is more likely to be caused by a streptococcal infection, particularly group A streptococcal, and severe continuous pain suggests necrotizing fasciitis. Infection must also be suspected and actively ruled out when a recently delivered woman has present vaginal bleeding and or abdominal pain. Every healthcare professional should be aware of the red flag symptoms and signs, should think about sepsis whenever he finds any of these symptoms or signs. Always think sepsis and stop sepsis. You have 6 hour strategy to timely obviate the progression of sepsis, 6 hour stop bundle. In these 6 hours, you need to obtain blood culture prior to antibiotic administration, administer broad-spectrum antibiotics within 1 hour of recognition of severe sepsis, measure serum lactate. In the event of hypotension and or serum lactate less than 4 mmol per liter, deliver an initial minimum of 20 mL per kg of crystalloid or an equivalent, apply vasopressors for hypotension that is not responding to initial flow resuscitation, to maintain mean arterial pressure of more than 65 mmHg. In the event of persistent hypotension despite flow resuscitation septic shock and or lactate more than 4 mmol per liter, achieve a central venous pressure of more than 8 mmHg, achieve central venous oxygen saturation of more than 70% or maxed venous oxygen saturation of more than 65%. Investigations in case of sepsis. There are general investigations, as we said, blood culture before antibiotics, full blood count, urea electrolytes, and C-reactive protein. And there are specific investigations which depend on the history and examination to identify the source of infection. Chest X-ray, pelvic ultrasound scan, CT scan if pelvic abscess suspected, salt swab, midstream urine, hyovaginal swab, placental swab, sputum, cerebrospinal fluid, epidural side swab, cesarean section, or episiotomy side wound swab, and expressed breast milk, and should ideally be obtained prior to starting antibiotic therapy, rapid mass screening, Please be aware that thrombocytosis high platelet count with a rising serum active protein and a swinging pyrexia usually indicate a collection of pus or an infected hematoma in the woman. One of the main goals of therapy is restore tissue perfusion. After giving the antibiotics in the first hour, you have to maintain tissue perfusion, especially in the event of hypotension or serum lactate of less than 4 mmol. You have to give a minimum of 20 mL/kg of crystalloid. And if the woman had persistent hypotension despite that fluid replacement and gestation, or lactate is more than 4 mmol, in this case you need an ICU input in order to maintain central venous pressure of more than 8 mmHg and central venous oxygen saturation of more than 70%. Antibiotics. Administration of intravenous broad-spectrum antibiotics is recommended within 1 hour of suspicion of severe sepsis, with or without septic shock. The antibiotics should be specific to source if known, and should be empirical if no source can be identified, until culture results can be used to narrow the antibacterial focus. Choice of antibiotics: piperacillin, tazobactam, or carbapenem plus clindamycin. If MRSA positive, glycopeptides such as vancomycin or teicoplanin may be added until sensitivity is known. Breastfeeding limits the use of some antimicrobial, hence the advice of a consultant microbiologist should be sought at an early stage. Other treatments, it depends on the focus of infection, so if you have a localized collection or an abscess, it needs to be drained or removed. Glucose control if the patient is diabetic, gastric stress ulcer prophylaxis with proton pump inhibitor, DVT prophylaxis, little rule in most cases for activated protein C or steroids. IVIG intravenous immunoglobulin is recommended for severe invasive streptococcal or staphylococcal infection if other therapy have failed. Sepsis following pregnancy. In sepsis following pregnancy, be aware of extragenital causes like mastitis, pneumonia, gastroenteritis, urinary tract infection, pharyngitis, skin and soft tissue infection, infection related to regional analgesia. And this can be highlighted by the history of the patient and main hair complaint and symptoms. For example, in mastitis, patient will present with pain and tenderness and redness in the breast area, sometimes navel discharging pus. In pneumonia, patient will present with upper respiratory tract infection. Gastroenteritis, patient will come with nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal pain. Urinary tract infection can be excluded by midstream urine, which show infection. Pharyngitis, skin and soft tissue infection can be usually excluded by an inspection, especially if there is an infection wound or an episiotomy, and infection related to regional analgesia, which is very important, especially if when she had an epidural analgesia. You have to be cautious about looking for epidural abscess and hematoma. There are certain clues in history and examination which can help you in managing sepsis. For example, early presentation of sepsis less than 12 hours post-birth is more likely to be caused by streptococcal infection, particularly group A streptococcus. Severe continuous pain suggests necrotizing fasciitis. Infection must also be suspected and actively ruled out when a recently delivered woman has persistent vaginal bleeding and abdominal pain. If there is any concern, the woman must be referred back to maternity unit as soon as possible. The speed of onset or deterioration in symptoms and signs is important. Early treatment with antibiotics, whether oral or parenteral, may be crucial in determining the outcome. Please remember, abdominal pain, fever greater than 38, and tachycardia more than 90 beats per minute are indication for admission for intravenous antibiotics. In hospital, high-dose intravenous broad-spectrum antibiotics should be started immediately without waiting for the results of investigation, because once infection becomes systemic, the woman's condition can deteriorate extremely rapidly with this in few hours if untreated. Combination of either piperacillin tazobactam or carbapenem plus clindamycin provide one of the broadest range of treatment for severe sepsis. MRSA may be resistant to clindamycin. Hence, if the woman is or high likely to be MRSA positive, glycopeptides such as vancomycin or teicoplanin may be added until sensitivity is known. Breastfeeding limits the use of some antimicrobial. Hence, the advice of a consultant microbiologist should be sought at an early stage. Please remember, treatment with antibiotics can cause allergic reactions and adverse effects, like skin rash. However, it should be remembered also, in toxic shock syndrome, maculopapular or blanching erythema maybe X-toxin related and not allergy to therapy. Diarrhea, particularly if offensive or developing after any antimicrobial therapy, should be sent for Clostridium difficile toxin testing. The organism does not infect neonate, but can cause up to 30% mortality in mothers if untreated. Pending the result of testing, oral metronidazole or oral vancomycin are used empirically where clinically justified. So also it's very important to be aware about the adverse reaction of drug. Sometimes the symptoms or the signs happening can be attributed to the disease itself, not the drug, and it's very important to rule a disease rather than saying it's an adverse reaction to treatment. Why do women die from septic shock? They can die due to myocardial depression, adult respiratory syndrome, this is rare from hypoxemia or hypercapnia, renal failure, liver dysfunction, asymptomatic encephalopathy, it's rare but can happen in septic shock. Management of septic shock. Overall goals, treat the mother, resuscitating the mother will resuscitate the fetus. Delivery attempt increase maternal and fetal mortality, assuming source is not intrauterine. Improve functional intravascular volume. Establish and maintain adequate airway. Determine the septic foci. Empirical antibiotic therapy. Surgical drainage of or removal of infected tissue. Corticosteroids, high doses don't increase survival. Physiological doses may be beneficial in extremely ill patient, relative adrenal insufficiency. Thank you.